Alhamdulillah, through the blessing of Allah the Almighty, through the grace of Allah the Almighty, today we recited verses from Surah Al-Nisa. We started Surah Al-Nisa yesterday, but we didn't complete it. Today we completed it. Now, from amongst the many verses in Surah Al-Nisa, one verse which Allah the Almighty mentions is, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْضُودًا. That indeed, salah has been fixed upon the believers, and it's not just been fixed, where they have to perform the 5-time daily prayers, they have to be compulsory, it's compulsory upon them, where they have to be punctual with it. But Allah the Almighty is saying that it is to be performed at a fixed time. So the 5-time daily prayers, they have to be performed at a fixed time. And many of the worships in Islam, many aspects of the worship, if we look at them in deep, then they are at a fixed time. And if you don't do them at the fixed time, then obviously you're held accountable unless you have a valid Sharia excuse not to do it in the fixed time. Now, even if we look at fasting, for example, the fast of Ramadan, they have to be kept within the month of Ramadan. And the blessings of the fasts are to keep them within the month of Ramadan. Many of us may not fast because it's hot. Many of us may not fast because we feel the fasts are too long, and we think we'll make up for them later on. And we won't have an excuse as well, a valid Sharia excuse, and obviously that is wrong. And then regarding this, it comes in a narration that من أفضل يوم من رمضان من غير رخصة ولا مرض لم يقضي عنه صوم الدهر كله وإن صام له. That whoever misses a fast of Ramadan, whoever misses a fast of Ramadan without a valid Sharia excuse, such as illness, etc., then even if he fasts for a whole lifetime after Ramadan, missing one fast, that whole lifetime of fasting will not atone for that one missed fast in Ramadan. So that's how important it is to fast within the month of Ramadan. As soon as the moon has been sighted for the opening of the month, then you have to start fasting. So this is the essence and the blessing of the time, to do things within the time. And Allah the Almighty is emphasizing in the verse that I mentioned at the start, that the 5-time daily prayers are to be perform at a fixed time. We all know the times, we have timetables, etc. And at the same time, as soon as we hit the age of puberty, if we've got youngsters, our young children, other brothers and sisters, youngsters, then as soon as they hit the age of puberty, they have to start being punctual with their 5-time daily prayers. They can't delay until old age, because the time starts once they have reached the age of puberty. And it's sad where many of us, we are very lazy when it comes to performing our 5-time daily prayers. And it's a sad state of affair, because Allah the Almighty, time and time again in the Quran, He's commanding us, He's ordering us, be punctual with the 5-time daily prayers, be punctual with the 5-time daily prayers. He's saying it, or He's ordering us, commanding us time and time again. And when Allah the Almighty commands us to do something, then we have to do it straight away. We've got no choice. We as people, humans in this world, if we've got people under us, for example, if we are parents and we have children, and we say to our children, can you please get me a glass of water, or can you please close the door, and our children are capable to do the command that we are telling them to carry out, and they don't carry out the command that we have told them to carry out, then what happens? We become saddened. We don't like it. We become upset with our children, because we're telling them to do something. We are older than them. They've got the ability to do it. We're not being oppressive. We're not being unjust. We're telling them to do something and they're not doing it, then we feel deeply saddened and we don't like it. Now, Allah the Almighty is telling us time and time again in the Quran, be punctual with the 5-time daily prayers, be punctual with the 5-time daily prayers, but we are blanking Him. We are not listening to His command. Imagine how He is feeling. Imagine how sad He is feeling. And then on top of that, we want Him to make things go our way. We don't want Him to do things that we want to go our way. So for example, we make dua and we say, oh Allah, please can you make such and such thing happen? But we are not functioning with our 5-time daily prayers. So it's very likely that Allah the Almighty, He will not respond to us because we are not even listening to His commands. Just like if we were to order our children to do something and they don't listen, we get upset. And they blank us time and time again, then obviously we deprive them from certain things as well. So imagine, you know, how Allah is feeling, and imagine His connection with us. Obviously it's going to be very weak, and we don't want it to be like that. We should use this month of Ramadan, where we have many communal acts such as the Taraweeh prayer, or such as when we gather for iftari, we see many people together, and that kind of drives us and pushes us to carry out aspects of worship. So we should use this month of Ramadan to help us become consistent with our five-time daily prayers, so we can be consistent outside Ramadan as well, and we can maintain that consistency. I pray Allah the Almighty give us the ability to be punctual with our five-time daily prayers. Now another verse that we recited in today's recital, Allah the Almighty, He mentions in the Quran, يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله. Allah the Almighty in this verse of Surah An-Nisa, He is ordering us to be just. Justice is something that is very important. Being just is very important in Islam. Allah the Almighty, He mentions justice a number of times in the Quran, that be just, don't do injustice to anyone, whether it's your own family members, whether it's your friends, whether it's your close acquaintances, anyone, don't be unjust to anyone. Justice is very important, and Islam emphasizes the importance of justice. Allah the Almighty in this verse, He's mentioning, even if you have to be just against your own family members, against your own relatives, then you have to be just. You can't be have that sense of injustice, because Allah the Almighty does not like that. And then further on in Surah Al-Ma'idah, another verse that we mentioned, and it's got the same words, but Allah the Almighty, He just adds the addition, that be just, why? Because it's more close to taqwa. Being just is equivalent to being someone that's God conscious. It's the side of someone that fears Allah. And like I mentioned in the past few days, if we look at many aspects of worship in Islam, then the conclusion or the purpose is to reach or to inculcate the quality of taqwa within ourselves. So to become a pious individual, to become God-fearing. And this is the essence of justice as well. That Allah the Almighty wants you to be just at all times, because you have to have this thought in your mind that Allah is watching you 24/7. So you've got this thought in your mind, no matter where you are, whether you're outside, whether you're inside, whether you're dealing with your own family members, whether you're dealing with people outside, whether you've got a business, then you have to be just. You can't cheat, you can't do things that will always be towards your advantage, against other people's advantage, but displeasing Allah. That is not what Allah the Almighty wants. In this day and age, we've got many injustice, many things that you could say are in relation to injustice. For example, you've got people bribing each other, and in countries, you know, in third world countries, you have bribery that's open, and people bribing each other. This is a sense of injustice as well, where some people will not have the money to do things, so obviously they cannot pay the bribe, but other people will have money to do things, so they can pay the bribe. Those that are taking the bribe, they're doing injustice then, because obviously bribery or taking a bribe in itself obviously is unlawful, but then there's the sense of justice amongst the public. And then you've got some so-called civilized countries where the injustice is happening on a more professional level, more behind the scenes, but all this is all wrong, and it's against the teachings of Islam, against the teachings of the Quran. So us as individuals, we need to be just amongst our family members. If we are leading an organization, for example, we have to be just in relation to everyone that is under us in that organization, that is working for that organization, and so on and so forth. And the essence is taqwa, like we mentioned in the past few days. Another few verses that we recited in today's recital, and I'll conclude with this, is a very interesting story, and it's the story of Prophet Adam alayhi salam's children, and more specifically, his two children were known as Habil and Qabil, and this is what the Mufassirun, the scholars of interpretation of the Quran, mentioned, that when Adam alayhi salam, when he came to this world, and obviously he was married to Hawa alayhi salam, and that was his wife. Then when he used to have children, then Allah the Almighty would bless him with twins. And within the twins, there would be a male and a female. So he would have one set of twins, for example, a male and a female. Then after a certain amount of time, he would have another set of twins, male and female. And what would happen with regards to marriage, obviously the progeny needs to last. We need the offspring to go until the Day of Judgment. So at that time, the Sharia was that the male of one set of twins will marry the female of another set of twins. And likewise, it will just carry on like this. But from within the male and female that were directly brothers and sisters from within the twins, they could not marry each other. They had to marry someone that was from another set of twins within, obviously, the same family. Now what happened with Habil and Qabil? Allah the Almighty, He mentions this within the Quran, and we recited it today. Allah the Almighty mentions, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ بَنِي آدَمَ بِالْحَقِّ, that with regards to Habil and Qabil, what happened was Habil, he had a sister, a twin sister. Qabil, he also had a twin sister. And obviously Habil was going to marry Qabil's sister, and Qabil would have to marry Habil's sister. But Qabil didn't want this to happen. Why? Because Qabil's own twin sister, she was very beautiful. And Habil's twin sister, she wasn't as beautiful. So Qabil, he wanted to marry his own twin sister because she was more beautiful. And he told Habil, his brother, that was obviously a twin of another sister, that you're not going to get married to my sister, my twin sister. Let me, I'm going to get married to her. You get married to your own sister, or later on if there's twins, etc. Then obviously that was not the Sharia of the time. So then they went to Adam al-Islam, their father. And Adam al-Islam said, no, that cannot happen. But obviously Qabil, he was very insisting that no, this has to happen. And obviously his sister was more beautiful. So he wanted to get married to his own twin sister. So Adam al-Islam, to settle it, what he said to them was, okay, what you do is you offer a sacrifice. So just like we sacrifice at the time of Qurbani, where we slaughter a goat, a sheep, etc. And then what we do is we distribute it, we eat it, etc. But in those times, the Sharia was when they used to offer a sacrifice, when they used to do Qurbani, they would have to perform the Qurbani and put the Qurbani animal, etc., on top of a mountain or a separate location. And then what would happen is, divinely, a fire would come or something would come and take the sacrifice away, which would show that the sacrifice has been accepted. So Adam alayhi salam, to settle this whole scenario, he said, you know what, Qabil, go and offer a sacrifice and let's see if it's accepted. So he offered a sacrifice, but it was not accepted. It was not accepted by Allah the Almighty. And then obviously, this was a sign that what Qabil was trying to do, getting married to his own sister, was wrong. And obviously, as per the Sharia, he should be married his other twin sister, Habil's sister. But he wasn't doing that, obviously. And then what happened was, Qabil, he made a plan. Because obviously, he was like, no, I want things to go my way. So he ended up killing Habil. He ended up killing Habil out of jealousy. And because obviously he didn't want Habil to get married to his own twin sister, so he ended up killing Habil. And when he killed Habil, Habil's body was just lying there. And then obviously he didn't know what to do. What should I do? And this was the first time someone had passed away at the time. So he didn't know about burial. So Allah the Almighty mentions that he sends a crow. Allah the Almighty sends a crow. And the commentators mention that Allah the Almighty sent two crows. One crow, they were arguing with each other. One crow ended up killing the other crow. And then the crow that survived, it ended up burying the other crow by digging up a bit of sand, soil, etc., and buried it in that sand and soil. And then Qabil saw this, and then obviously Qabil, he also acted upon this and he buried his own brother. Now this is the first time that murder took place on the face of this earth when the human race started. So Qabil is known to be the first murderer. And on top of this, he carried out this act of injustice out of jealousy, out of jealousy. Now jealousy, it's a very big spiritual disease and a spiritual malady that could basically eat a person, and it destroys a person. And it comes in a narration that jealousy, it eats away our good deeds just like fire eats away wood. Jealousy eats away our good deeds just like fire eats away wood. So this disease of jealousy, it's a very big disease that if it's prevalent amongst us, or if we have this disease, we need to get rid of this disease. And unfortunately, it's very common, and obviously humans can easily become prone to this disease because there's so many things around you. Sometimes an individual, he's not got so much money, and then he sees someone that's got more money, then he becomes jealous. But if such a scenario comes upon an individual, then he should think about Allah. He should thank Allah the Almighty for what he has been blessed with. And that is why scholars mention, and it comes in a narration, when it comes to worldly things, when it comes to worldly things like wealth, assets, or jobs, etc., where other people are on a more higher level, then you should always look at those that are lower than you. And when it comes to religion, always look at those people that are higher than you. So I'll give you an example. So for example, someone's really pious, and we know them. And we know that he's known for being punctual with his 5-time daily prayers. He recites Quran on a daily basis. He's known to be very pious. We should always look up at such a person. But when we know that someone is very rich, then we don't look at them. We look at those people that are below us. So for example, Allah has blessed us with a bit of wealth. Now we, when it comes to wealth, should look at those people that are suffering from poverty. Those people that are living on the streets. Those people that are homeless. Those people that are not being blessed the same food that we are blessed with on a daily basis. We should be looking at the war-torn countries such as Syria, Palestine, Yemen, and those people that are not being blessed with the food and the same type of shelter that we are being blessed with. This will help us in this world. And this is a great solution to get rid of jealousy. Now when it comes to religious aspects, always look at those people that are higher than us, that are excelling, that are closer to Allah. And when it comes to worldly aspects, always look at those people that are lower than us and that are below us. I pray Allah the Almighty give us the ability to be punctual with our 5-time daily prayers. I pray Allah the Almighty give us the ability to be just at all times. And I pray Allah the Almighty give us the ability to act upon everything that has been said. Ameen. Ameen. Wa akhiru da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidil mursaleen. Allahumma rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahma innaka antal wahhab. Ameen. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. آمين. اللهم ارزقنا شهادة في سبيلك واجعل موتنا في بلد رسولك. آمين. اللهم زكي نفوسنا أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. آمين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. آمين. اللهم حاسبنا حساب يسيرا. اللهم حاسبنا حساب يسيرا. اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا يا كريم. اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا يا غفور. يا الله please forgive all of our sins. يا الله please forgive all of our sins. يا الله please give us all the ability to be just at all times. يا الله please give us all the ability to inculcate into ourselves the quality of taqwa. Ya Allah, please make us God conscious all the time. Ya Allah, please make us aware at all times that you are watching us 24/7. Ya Allah, please make us from amongst your accepted servants. Ya Allah, please make us from amongst your closest of friends. Ya Allah, please grant us all long, healthy and prosperous lives. Ya Allah, please grant us all long, healthy and prosperous lives. Ya Allah, please make us punctual with our 5-time daily prayers. Ya Allah, please safeguard our iman. Ya Allah, in this blessed month of Ramadan, Ya Allah, please make us benefit as much as possible. Ya Allah, please make us spiritually uplifted as much as possible. Ya Allah, please spiritually recharge us. Ya Allah, please make us carry out worship as much as possible. Ya Allah, please make this month a means of our admittance to paradise. Mm-hmm. Ya Allah, please make this month a means of our deliverance from hellfire. Allahumma inna nas'aluka min khayri ma sa'alaka min nabiyyika wa habibika Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa na'udhu bika min sharri ma sa'alaka min nabiyyika wa habibika Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أنت المستعان وعليك البلاء لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. آمين برحمتك يا الله.